Welcome back to Putalain Jaya Gospel Hall Church Education Program. We're in the midst of our series on the Acts of the Apostles, and this is part 3 of the introduction to the Acts of the Apostles. In this episode, we are going to look at the purpose of writing. Why did Luke write the Acts of the Apostles? Now, the first thing that we need to realize is that the Gospel of Luke and the Acts of the Apostles form a two-part series on its own. Now, there's Volume 1, the Gospel of Luke, and Volume 2, the Acts of the Apostles. So, the unity between these two volumes means that whatever Luke said was his purpose of writing the Gospel of Luke was probably also why he wrote the Acts of the Apostles. So, let's read what Luke says was his intention for writing. Luke chapter 1 verses 1 to 4. Inasmuch as many have undertaken to compile a narrative of the things that have been accomplished among us, just as those who from the beginning, meaning the apostles, were eyewitnesses and ministers of the word, have delivered them to us. It seemed good to me also, having followed all things closely for some time past, to write an orderly account for you, most excellent Theophilus, and here's the point, so that you may have certainty, and this is him giving the reason for writing, that you may have certainty concerning the things you have been taught. So basically, Theophilus and people like him have been taught certain things concerning Jesus and concerning the Christian faith, and they have come to faith as a result of that. And now Luke finds it important for him to write the Gospel of Luke and the Acts of the Apostles to reinforce the things Theophilus and people like him have learned about the faith. Why does he need to reinforce their learning? Well, we shall see. Now, first up is the idea that Luke was trying to reconcile the Jewish and Gentile factions of the church. So this comes from Tubingen School. According to this thinking, Acts of the Apostles were written to rewrite the history of the early church so that the Jewish and Gentile factions of the church may be reconciled in its second century context. So basically, the Tubingen School says that Acts was written in the second century, 115 to 130 Common Era. Now, why? To rewrite, it means that originally the history of the church, of the early church, was like this. There was a Jewish faction that roughly follows the teachings of Peter, and there is the Gentile factions of the church that roughly follows the teachings of Paul. And these two were at loggerheads, their teachings. There's the Jewish faction and the Gentile faction. So what Luke was doing, or rather the author, not necessarily Luke, since this is way into the second century, according to Tubingen School, there are these two factions, right? Peter is the apostle to the Jews, while Paul was the apostle to the Gentiles. So what the author did was to paint the apostle to the Jew, Peter, as someone who was pro-Gentile in the Cornelius episodes, for example. And also to paint Paul, the apostle to the Gentiles, as someone who is pro-Jewish, given that he circumcised Timothy, he kept the Nazarite vow, he was willing to sponsor those people who were offering sacrifices in the temple. So basically, what the Tubingen School say is that in the second century, these two factions were, there is unease and tension between them. And so the author was rewriting the history of the early church in order to provide a harmonious account of the history of the early church, with the hopes of reconciling the two parties. Now, I've argued in the previous video that there was absolutely, in the previous video, there was absolutely no reason for us to think that if this was true, that this was what the author was trying to do, to reconcile these two factions, and this, there were these two factions, then it doesn't stand to reason that the only context where this would fit would be a second century context. This fits also very well in the first century context. If we read Romans, we read Galatians, we read Philippians, we read some of these writings by Paul, we can see the tension between Jewish believers in Jesus and also Gentile believers in Jesus, and how they were trying to work out their differences there. Now, so people who are against the Tübingen school, they tend to show that Peter and Paul agree more than they disagree with regards to the essential matter of faith. So those who wants to counter the Tübingen school often takes this route, say, hey, you know what, there isn't that really that much of a difference between Peter and Paul. But that, I don't think, was what the Tübingen school was talking about. Not talking about Peter and Paul, but rather talking about the Jewish faction that rallies around Peter and the Gentile faction that rallied around Paul. I think that would be more accurate. Well, another potential purpose of writing is for evangelism and apologetics. Now, on the evangelistic front, surely it is one of the purpose, I suppose, because there's the inclusion of a number of evangelistic speeches and miraculous accreditations that attends to the speeches. So I suppose one of the reasons why the speeches were written down, instead of just saying Peter preaching this place and Paul preaching the other place, but instead of doing that, to write down the speeches, perhaps it is for evangelistic purposes. Well, on the apologetic side, perhaps it is to create an apologetic for Christianity in the eyes of the Romans, and or vice versa. So what this means is that maybe Christianity wasn't thought to be acceptable among the Romans. First of all, it is greatly related to Judaism. Maybe they feel a bit suspicious with the Jewish people. We are Romans, are supposed to worship Jupiter, and the Greeks were supposed to worship Zeus. And now, you know, do we really want to convert to Christianity and worship the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob? Is this group dangerous? Okay, so to create an apologetic for Christianity in the eyes of the Romans, and or vice versa, maybe it is to create an apologetic for the Romans in the eyes of Christians by portraying the Romans in rather positive light. In the book of Acts, maybe it is to show Christians that the Romans were not enemies, they would support us even when the unbelieving Jews were against us, those kind of apologetics. Now, we also observe that almost one-fourth of the book of Acts, from chapter 22 to chapter 28, is devoted to Paul's trials and defenses. Paul was going through trials and defenses. Now, why devote so much material to do that? Perhaps is to prove that Christianity ought to be a legal religion. So now, if you were in Judaism, then you have a special permission to not perform sacrifices or participate in worship services of the official religion of the empire, which was imperial worship. You don't have to worship the emperors of Rome, and Jews would never do that in large numbers, right? Maybe there's one or two like that, but as a nation, they were very, very loyal to the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. It's very hard to move them away from monotheism. So perhaps the Roman Empire knew that and said, hey, you know what, if you're in Judaism, if you worship the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, then you're exempted from this. But Christianity, though, now, for the most part, you know, in Jerusalem at least, the Christians, they met in the temple, they participated in the temple services, they participated in the temple prayers and sacrifices. For all intents and purposes, they were Jews and within Judaism, but they believed that the Messiah has come and he was Jesus. Every other Jew was hoping for the Messiah to come. They think the Messiah is yet to come. But this group of Jews said the Messiah has come and he is Jesus, and salvation can only be found in by believing in Jesus Christ. So this sounds very Jewish, right? This is Judaism, a variant of it called the Way. But maybe other people don't think so. You see, at Antioch, they were first called Christians because there were these Gentiles also joined the church, and it doesn't seem that they were very much into Judaism, into the circumcision, the food laws, the Sabbath, etc. Is this really Judaism? Now, if it is not Judaism, then the protection that exempts, the exemption for Jews to from worshipping the emperor would not be extended to the Christians, and that would be trouble for the believers. So maybe in Paul's trials and defenses, Luke was trying to show that Christianity ought to be considered either a variant of Judaism or something that should be allowed altogether. Now, the scholar Konzelman, he has an interesting idea, thinking that also written that the Acts of the Apostles was written in the second century, and by that time, if it was written in the second century, then all the apostles would have died, many of their co-workers would have died as well, and perhaps initially they were thinking that Jesus Christ would return in their lifetime, returning very soon, and so they didn't have many things in place. So now that the apostles have died, long gone, and the church need to, all right, Jesus is not coming back yet, so we are going to be in it for the long haul. And so, so according to Konzelman, one possible reason for the author to write the Acts of the Apostles was to create this narrative to respond to the delayed parousia, to delayed second coming of Christ. Okay, now the third possibility is edification, and this is where I think it makes the most sense to me, especially the first point, to confirm the gospel to recent converts, such as Theophilus, because we must respect what Luke himself said, the purpose of writing. It seemed good to me also to write an orderly account for you, to whom? To this Gentile believer, most excellent Theophilus, and people like him, that you may have certainty concerning the things you have been taught. That means they are recent converts, they have been taught certain things about Jesus, and now is to confirm the gospel to reinforce that message. Now, why was this necessary? I think something like this could have happened, right? Just imagine this. So you are Theophilus, and before this you have been worshipping Jupiter, or you'll be worshipping Zeus, Apollos, or the gods of Olympus, or something like that. You have Jewish friends. You are someone who's well placed in society, and then lo and behold, someone came to you and tell you about Jesus. Now, these people or this person who t- tells you about Jesus was probably either Paul himself or someone associated with Paul's ministry, right? As the missionary party moves to various places in the Gentile world. Paul was the apostle to the Gentiles after all. So Paul and his friends were going everywhere, establishing churches, preaching to people, and Theophilus and his friends, his associates, could have heard of the gospel from them and believed. So imagine Theophilus, he believed in Jesus and he's happy. Now he's worshiping the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the one true God. He's no longer worshiping Jupiter. He's no longer worshiping Zeus, the gods of Olympus. And then he went out and he met his Jewish friend and he came and said, "Hey, Judah," that would be his friend's name. "Hey, Judah. I have converted to the worship of the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob." And Judah says, "Congratulations, I've always been praying for you." "I've been praying for you, and finally you have converted to Judaism. We are brothers. Now, why didn't you tell me about it? When were you circumcised?" And Theophilus says, "I was never circumcised." And Judah say, "What, you were never circumcised? What do you mean that you have now embraced the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob? All right, maybe you are in the process somewhat. Okay, how about this? Have you stopped eating pork? Are you now keeping kosher food?" He says, no, I'm not keeping kosher food. I was not taught to do that. You were not even taught to keep kosher food? How about Sabbath? Observing the Sabbath. Hey, that is really basic." And Theophilus says, no, we don't do that either. We meet on Sundays. We don't observe the Sabbath." And Judah asked, "What kind of Judaism is that? What kind of worship of the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob is that? This must be some kind of a joke. Look, here's the Torah, right? Here is the Tanakh, the Old Testament, the Hebrew Bible. Now let me show you all these places where the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob himself will command these things: the Sabbath, the kosher food, the circumcision, all these things. How can you not do any of this, fail to obey any of this, and still claim to be a believer in God?" And Theophilus says, we were baptized. I was baptized. What, baptized? You joined that group, didn't you? Yeah, the Jesus group. They told me that all I need to do is to place my trust in Jesus Christ and I will have access to the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And Judah says, "Theophilus, my old friend, you are terribly mistaken. That's a cult. Who did you learn it from?" Wait. Maybe saying that that's a cult is going a bit too far. Well, back in Jerusalem, we have James, the brother of Jesus. He's fine. He's great. Yeah, he's a bit weird. He believes that the Messiah has already come. But, you know, the rest of us don't think so. Well, fair enough. One day the Messiah has to come and he thinks that the Messiah has already come and he is Jesus. He is Jesus of Nazareth. Well, okay, we can agree to disagree. That is Judaism. What he is doing, that is Judaism. But what is this that you're talking about? I've never heard of anything like that before. Who taught you this stuff? And Theophilus says, "Paul, Saul of Tarsus." And Judah goes, that rascal. I have heard of him. He is this guy who goes everywhere causing trouble for the Jews. You know, he's just trouble. In fact, the high priest in Jerusalem, he says that, you know, we ought to kill this guy, right? We ought to imprison him and to stone him to death for blasphemy. He's going everywhere teaching people to no longer obey the teachings of Moses, to no longer circumcise their children, and things like that. Terrible guy, terrible guy. But Theophilus said, no, I heard his preaching and I was convicted. And I have the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit, I was told, not circumcision, but the Holy Spirit, I was told, is the mark of someone who is part of God's people. And Judah says, that's very subjective, the Holy Spirit. You know what's really objective? What is Judaism? Now, for example, if you want to know what is, let's just say we have a couple of people who are debating about whether the Shaolin martial art, this move should be done this way or should be done the other way. Now, the best way to resolve the dispute, the ultimate way to resolve the dispute is to go to the Shaolin temple and ask the abbot himself, and he would settle it for us once and for all whether which one is valid, right? So that sounds reasonable. Hey, Theophilus, why don't we go to Jerusalem, we go to the temple and ask the chief priest of Judaism himself, correct? Whether Paul's preaching is valid, whether if anyone believes what Paul says, they would end up worshipping the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob or not. So you see, what happens is that Theophilus' faith is shaken. All of a sudden, he has all these doubts. Wait a minute, did I get myself into a cult? I mean, Paul, yeah, I heard that he wasn't even one of the 12, right? Wait a minute. So all these thoughts comes to his mind, I suppose. So I guess this would be a good reason for Luke to write both the Acts of the Apostles and also the Gospel of Luke. So I think that this scenario fits very well with what Luke is saying here. It seemed good to me also to write an orderly account for you, most excellent Theophilus, that you may have certainty concerning the things you have been taught. Now, there are other edification purpose of writing. For example, to discuss the place of Christianity amidst the Greco-Roman religious philosophical options. There is the pagan religion, there is the Jewish religion, and there is all these philosophical options. There's Stoicism, there is Epicureanism, etc. And to carve out that space for Christianity, that is entirely possible. And finally, to affirm Christianity's claim to be God's people, which is related to what I just said earlier, right? I mean, for Christianity to say that anyone who believes in Jesus Christ, these are the people who are legitimate successors of the salvation history that begin with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, right? So for Christianity to claim that they are God's people, that they truly worship the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob through Jesus the Messiah. So there you go. These are some of the purposes, possible purposes of writing. I lean towards the edification aspect because that is what Luke himself said is what he was trying to do, and I think that the main point was to confirm the gospel to recent converts, for example Theophilus, who may be confused about the place of Christianity within the salvation history of God's revelation from Genesis to Malachi. All right, there you go. And next time we meet, we will go right into Acts chapter 1.